Dear students, welcome back to the second lecture of dynamometer. Now, in previous session, we had seen two types of absorption dynamometer, that is Prani brake dynamometer and rope brake dynamometer. Now, today we are going to see the belt transmission dynamometer, which is the part of transmission dynamometer. Now, already we have seen the difference between the absorption and transmission type of dynamometer. So, we know that in transmission type of dynamometer, the power generated by the engine is measured during its operation itself, so there is no need to absorb the power or separately install the absorption system to measure power generated by the engine. So this is the beauty of the transmission type of dynamometer, and hence these types of dynamometer are widely used to measure power generated by the engine. Now here we can see the arrangement of belt transmission type of dynamometer. It consists of the driving pulley, which is directly attached to the engine shaft, and driven pulley attached to the application where power is needed to supply. Now a belt is connected in such a way that the driving pulley is connected to driven pulley by means of two idler pulleys. Now here the driving pulley A, the idler pulley C and idler pulley D have same diameters, and belt is moving from A to C, C to B and B to D. In this way the power is belt is getting connected to from driving pulley to driven pulley. Now as far as the pulleys C and D are concerned, they are pinned to the lever which is pivoted at O. Now this lever is having balancing weight at one end. Here it have the balancing weight, which is fixed weight, and at the second end it had the dead weight, which is adjustable weight. Now it also contains stopper so that the lever will not move up and down beyond certain limit. Here we can see the belt tensions. Now definitely when the pulley rotates, this pulley, that is driving pulley, rotates in anticlockwise direction, belt tension T1 on this side will be greater than belt tension T2 on this side. So we can say that the T1 is the tight side, whereas T2 is the slack side in this case. Now we again go in detail. If we say T1 is the tension on tight side, then at point D, that is the center of pulley D, the total force exerted will be equal to 2T1. That is because of this belt and this belt, the total tension, total force on the point D will be 2T1, and the direction of the force will be in upward direction. Now, in case for pulley C, we can say that the total force at C will be equal to 2T2. Because of these two belts, and the direction will be in upward side. Now, as we know that T1 is greater than T2, definitely the force at D will be greater than the force at C. And due to this, what will happen? The lever will tend to move anticlockwise about point O. Now, as it will move anticlockwise in upward direction, we will add the weight so that the lever will be made horizontal. And as and when this lever will become horizontal, we can say that the arrangement is in equilibrium condition. So at this equilibrium condition, we can say that the moment at point O is zero. That is, the moment generated by the force at C, by the force at D, and by the force at dead weight at point O, the total summation of all the moment due to these forces will be equal to zero. Hence, if we sum up the equation, the summation M will be zero about point O. Therefore, 2T1 here at point D, 2T1 into A, where A is the distance between the O and D. So this is anticlockwise moment. So 2T1 into A will be equal to 2T2 into A, as the distance is same again, and plus it will be added by the moment generated by the weight, which is also in clockwise direction. So therefore, we can say that T1 minus C2, as A is common, T1 minus C2 will be equal to W into L. Now, why this W into L? Because where W is the weight of this system that is attached to the pan, and L is the distance of this weight from O. And so this is the W into L is the moment generated by the weight. Therefore, T1 minus C2 is equal to W into L by 2A. Hence, we can say that power generated by the engine will be equal to the difference of the tension into peripheral velocity, where peripheral velocity V is the velocity of belt. Therefore, we can again write the equation as T1 minus T2 into pi dN by 60, where D is the diameter of pulley and N the RPM of pulley. So let us discuss a problem on belt transmission type of dynamometer. So in this problem, we have given that in the belt transmission diameter, the driving pulley rotates at 400 RPM. So if we redraw the diagram which we had seen in the previous discussion, so same diagram we had drawn here, and given the dimensions which are provided in the problem. So it is given that driving pulley, now this is our driving pulley and it rotates at 400 RPM. So let us say N is equal to 400 RPM. Now the distance between the center of driving pulley and dead mass is 820 mm. So the distance between dead mass and point O is given to us as 820 mm, and let's say L is equal to 820 mm, that is 0.82 meter. The third dimension which is given to us is the diameter of each driving as well as intermediate pulleys is equal to 360 mm. Now this diameter of these two three pulleys is given to us as 360 mm. Okay, now find the value of the dead mass required to maintain the lever in horizontal position. It is required to find the weight of the dead mass which will keep this horizontal when the power generated by the engine is equal to 5 kW. So this is our arrangement, and these three pulleys have same diameter, that is 360 mm. This is a bigger pulley and the diameter is not given to us. The power generated by the engine is given to us as 5 kW, that is 5 × 10⁻³ W. Now it is also required to find the value of the weight, that is find its weight when belt just begins to slip on the driving pulley. So mu being 0.25, so in that case the coefficient of friction is to be considered as 0.25 between the belt and pulley, and maximum tension in the belt is 1500 N. So let us start the problem. Here it is given given data already we had written. So if we see the diagram, let us say T1 is the tension on tight side and T2 is the tension on slack side. So in that case the force at pulley 2 will be equal to 2T2, and force at pulley 1 will be equal to 2T2. Sorry, this force at 2 will be equal to 2T1 and force at 1 will be equal to 2T2. So let's say the upward force at pulley 2, this pulley 2 is equal to 2T1 and pulley 1 equal to 2T2. So therefore, taking the moment about O, we can say that weight into the distance is equal to 2T1 into the distance A and minus the 2T2 into distance, that is the same 360 mm. Now here T1 minus T2 is equal to, we can say that if we put the these values and take out T1 minus T2, as this value is same, T1 minus T2 is equal to 1.1388 W, where W is not known to us. Now here question arises, two things are there. One, by mistake it is written here T1, this is T2, and secondly you may ask that why we have taken this distance equal to 360 mm, which actually that this distance is not given to us, then how we can take this distance as 360? So if we see the arrangement here, this point to this point, this belt is exactly vertical, so half of the distance is nothing but the radius of this pulley and half of the distance is nothing but equal to radius of second pulley. So radius of this one and radius of the driving pulley, it will be equal to diameter of this pulley, and this diameter of the pulley is given to us as 360 mm. So we can take A equal to 360 mm. Now from continuing this equation, power we can compute as T1 minus T2 into pi dN upon 60. Now T1 minus T2 in terms of W is known, whereas P is also known to us. So putting the value of P as 5000 watt will and the value of T1 minus T2 equal in terms of weight. Also we know the diameter of pulley and we know the RPM, that is rotational velocity of pulley. So putting these values we can directly get the weight required to keep this lever horizontal. So this weight comes out as 582.319 Newton. Now coming to the second part of this problem, it is being asked to find the weight when it will have the maximum belt tension of 1500 Newton and the coefficient of friction can be maximum to 0.25. So in that case we need to find the value of W. So we know that if mu is equal to 0.25 and the T1 is the max, definitely T1 is greater than T2, therefore maximum value of T1 can reach to 1500 Newton. So again, as far as belt is concerned, we know that T1 by T2 is equal to e raised to power mu theta. So this equation actually takes into account the ratio of T1 by T2. So the value of this T1 by T2 is definitely governed by coefficient of friction and the angle of contact. Now in this particular case, angle of contact of the belt over the pulley is 180 degree, as the arrangement shown here. Everywhere you will see that the angle of contact of the belt over the pulley is 180 degree. Therefore coefficient of friction and the angle of contact restricts the ratio. It cannot exceed over e raised to power mu theta. Now as we know that the value of mu, the value of theta and value of T1, that is maximum tension in the belt, we can compute the value of T2. Therefore T1 by T2 is equal to e raised to power mu, that is 0.25 into pi, where pi is the angle of contact, 180 degree. In terms of radian we have taken it as pi, and therefore T2 comes to us as 683 newton. Now taking again the moment about O and putting these values again, we will see that the weight required will be 716 newton approximately. So here, as the belt tension increases, weight required to balance the lever also increases. The second type of dynamometer under transmission type of dynamometer is torsion dynamometer. Now what is torsion? You know that the torsion is nothing but the twist in the shaft. So torsional dynamometer works on the same phenomena. When the shaft is twisted, the torsion in the shaft will exist, and this will be used to measure the power transmitted by the engine. Now here, this type of particular dynamometer is used to measure large amount of power, particularly in case of propeller shaft of a turbine or motor vessel, etc. Now during transmission, the driving end of the shaft twists through some angle, and this angle will decide the amount of power. Here definitely the angle twisted will be very small, but that small angle will also can tell us about the total power transmitted by the engine. Now here, how we can compute that value? That is the question. Now, as we say, the angle of twist. The angle of twist, the amount of twist depends upon many factors such as the torque acting on the shaft, that is T, length of the shaft, that is L, diameter of the shaft, that is D, and modulus of rigidity, C, of the material of the shaft. Now definitely when the shaft will twist, it will try to resist the twist, and this resistance will depend upon the modulus of rigidity of the material of the shaft, the diameter of the shaft, the length of the shaft, and the torque acting on the shaft. So these factors are responsible for the angle of twist in the shaft. Now in torsion, in strength of material, you have already gone through this equation, that is T by J is equal to C theta by L, where T is the torque, J is the polar moment of inertia, C is the modulus of rigidity, theta is the angle of twist, and L is the length of the shaft. Now diameter is not going to get included in this particular equation, so it is taken care by J, where J is the polar moment of inertia. Now as far as shaft is concerned, there are two types of shaft, that is one solid shaft and second hollow shaft. For solid shaft, the value of J is pi by 32 d raised to power 4, whereas for hollow shaft it is pi by 34 capital D raised to power 4 minus small d raised to power 4, where capital D is the outer diameter of the shaft and small d is the inner diameter of the hole. Now from this above equation, if we see, we can find the value of torque transmitted by the shaft will be equal to C into J upon L into theta. Now here, as far as the dimensions of the shaft are concerned and material of the shaft is concerned, the value of C, value of J, and value of L becomes constant, because it's fixed with the material and its dimension. Therefore only theta is the variable. So we can say that T is equal to K into theta, where K is the constant and equal to Cj by L. So thus T, torque, is a function of theta only, and if we become able to measure the amount of twist in the shaft by any means, then we can compute the amount of torque and thereby the amount of power transmitted or generated by the engine.